Okay, as you know, I'm a clinician and I would like to. I'm not going to talk about trials because there is someone after me that is going to talk about trials. So I'm going to talk about what are the issues related to the trials in this area. I do not have any disclosure for this presentation and well, this is my first slide. You know, we passed through some in a situation when I started to work, when we had a few drugs, we were giving the same drug to the patient, and afterward we are trying to understand what's going on. And now we have a completely different perspective. We try to select the patient for the proper drug, and this way, for those patients, we are increasing I wouldn't say the cure rate, but the outcome of the treatment. The other big issue is that once to develop a drug, there were a long time from the bench to the market, and nowadays you can see that this is one of the last drug approved. There are many indications registered in a few years, and the development is about 1/5 of the time that was necessary for other drugs, similar or chemotherapeutic. As a matter of fact, we were discussing yesterday about having the proper drug to treat patients when we select some kind of target. We cannot complain too much because, as I told you, I started with less than 10 drugs to treat patients, and just in the 4 years between 2012 and 2016, there were approved more than 120 indications. Of course, with some difference between the different drug agencies. And last year, there were about another 80 drugs that were discussed to be approved. As you can see, the drugs that are going to be approved are partly immunotherapeutic agents, but not only. There are a lot of drugs related to epigenetic and target, so we are back to some new drug related to what we can assess in the tumor biology. But as a matter of fact, we have a lot of problems to develop drug because there is an issue about data. You know that the first target agent, imatinib, was approved without a phase III trial. And recently we have the story of mismatch repair patient with colorectal cancer or any other cancer that have a drug approved in the United States, and the drug is not going even submitted to the European Drug Agency because they're concerned about not having a randomized study in such kind of patient. So there is differences. There is a lot of problem for the country like ours where there is a negotiation about the price, which is of course in the interest of the population because we want to have the drug available for any patient, but that takes time. And there are no clear. I'm the guy that created many years ago the risk-sharing system in Italy, but it's not anymore actual, so we have to change our mind about. We do not have really secondary research, and there are a lot of problems about the consensus, how to take care of the variability in healthcare. And this is the reason for what Wutke says, the clinical trial system is broken just a few months ago. Anyhow, we had a lot of target that has been implemented to develop drugs. As you can see, many of them are already in the market and many are coming, and so we are happy about. But if we are going to have a landscape of the whole tumor system, and you can see, I don't know if I can use this one, yeah? You can see that those are the opportunity, the arrows, and the circle are where we are with some kind of precision medicine for this kind of tumor. So not far away. There are a few tumors where we can really propose a personalized treatment for the majority of patients. And the other point is that we did not cure yet a patient with a target agent, or at least a few of them. We are trying to discuss something about in the melanoma. We have some experience in renal, but you know, long-term remission, yes, cure is a different story, and this is another problem. The third problem, which is something that is, on my point of view, very, very important as a consequence of this meeting, is that we are not just thinking about precision medicine to cure people, but we can also consider precision medicine to prevent and make an early diagnosis, which is, on my point of view, the best application of precision medicine in this moment for the future. In term, to make a short, a long story, there was a system that was related to the basic research providing some data for clinical trial, epidemiology, and health service. Now, things are a little bit more complicated because clinical trial, epidemiology, and health service research should provide information that can bring us to a guideline and healthcare policies, which is the reason for what we develop drug. I'm sorry if I'm going to talk about these things in a meeting so full of science, but science needs to the people, and people need science if they can get some advantage from. So my idea is that we should come out of the science toward the cure of the patient. And to make this, we have to convince politics and doctors and community to define standard of cares, guidelines, and how to invest their money. And this is the reason for what we design studies. As a matter of fact, once the development of a drug was very complicated, there was the phase one, the phase two, the phase three, that could take more than 10 years to develop a single agent. Nowadays, we completely changed the system because from the phase one to the phase three, without passing through a phase two, there are a lot of examples in development. And there are a lot of examples how to change the statistical design of the study. But still, we have question open because sometimes we arrive on the market with drugs that we do not know well enough. And especially in this situation, we do not know how long we have to go ahead with the treatment. We do not know how to select the patient on the way. And we have a number of clinical problems that I will try to explain to you. The first one, on my clinical point of view, is heterogeneity, and I think is the most important. Because when you propose to me a very precise definition of the genomic profile of a tumor, or of the genome of a person, you are doing something in a fixed moment. But there is a dynamic process, which is called evolution. And evolution provides that all this target proliferation, excuse me, I did something wrong, and the possible target that we develop, they can create heterogeneity inside and outside of the tumor. And this thing was well known since many years ago, because that was defined since the 1958, at least. And the second point is that we are going to talk about resistance and heterogeneity. There is not only the tumor, but there are also the situation where patients are not able to take the drug because they cannot. They do not metabolize the drug. They have some interaction with other drugs. And this is the clinical problem that we have to take care of when we treat the patient. Talking about heterogeneity, we can see that there are, those are very famous descriptions, that there are main mutation and clonal event, and the interaction between these two kind of event and the process when they happen are conditioning the evolution of the tumor. As a matter of fact, when we are talking about evolution, we are talking about ourselves. The difference is that ourselves, on my understanding, but correct me if I'm wrong, we develop in an evolutionary process that was for millions of years, while the tumor has an evolution that happens in a few months or over years, which makes everything very complex. And in the evolution, we have to take in consideration also the microenvironment that are supporting the tumor growth. And this is the reason for what someone tried to start to understand, because to go ahead and to design better studies, we should understand who we are treating, what kind of tumor are treating. And so if the tumor are, there is a diversity inside of the tumor, or if there is a changing of the diversity inside the tumor in time, those are very important issues talking about evolution of the tumor. And then there are the situations where the tumor can found, if there is something that is really dealing against the tumor, or if there is a missing of resources for the tumor, makes a difference. So if we try to classify the evolution in an index, we can consider that there are low diversity and high diversity at the beginning, and according how they develop on time, we can have a different situation in the same patient during time. And for the same reason, if we are going to take in consideration if the patient has something that is already defeating the tumor by itself or not, is making a difference. At the same time, there is the necessity of the tumor to have an access to metabolic support for its growth. And for this reason, we can consider that different kind of approach we have are going to change also diversity of the tumor. For example, tumor that have not much diversity and a lot of metabolic support can be defeated by chemotherapy that on one side are blocking maybe the tumor growth, but on the other side is increasing the diversity. Immunotherapy, apparently, according to what we know about the mutational burden, taking advantage from the diversity, but is not impacting anyhow to the metabolic process. And the target therapy works somehow in the same way, while anti-angiogenesis, for example, it works more on the metabolic approach. So those are the tools that we have, and this is the landscape we should take in consideration to design the study and the process. And this is a slide that was presented already yesterday, from Pilar, and it shows that, like at the beginning, we can have an intertumor heterogeneity in the same kind of tumor, according for what kind of gene is activated. But of course, this kind of process that goes through the presence of targetable lesion, take into consideration also the problem of the response to the stress, what is dealing with the survival, and what is dealing with the metabolism. And this is a dynamic process. And also our research is a dynamic process because we are implementing our drugs and our combination on time, but developing one drug at the time. So what we are missing in the drug design and the study of the drug development is the strategy. We are accustomed nowadays just to develop one drug to assess what is the advantage of the drug in that clinical situation. But on the clinical point of view, this is not anymore updated. We need to understand what is the place in therapy of the drug and what we are going to do to treat the patient. As a matter of fact, what's happening is this. Now, we can have a tumor very well defined or profiled by molecular for its molecular features, found a drug that is improving the tumor control, and at some time the tumor is developing some clone that is resistant. And for example, this is what's happened in acquired resistance for lung cancer, and you can see that for just this kind of mutation of target, ALK, we have so many drug developed on the time, and finally, apparently, there is one that is dealing with any mutation that can be can appear as secondary mutation for a treatment with the first drug. And our question is: should we start to treat this patient with the drug more potent at the beginning, or should we consider a sequence of treatment, or are these enough because there are many other mechanisms of resistance to an activation ALK like meta activation or transformation on the mesenchymal profile and so on. So this is one point. So those drugs have been developed in the same set of patient, and the question that we have is which is the best drug to start with? And there are no trials that are answering this question. Same thing happened for the colorectal cancer model, where you can see there are many different mutation that can appear in the second time after we start to treat the patient with anti-GFR and with efficacy. And plus, we have some problem with the intratumor heterogeneity. And colorectal cancer is very interesting as a model because now, according where the tumor grow, we have a different profile and we have a higher probability to have resistance to some kind of drug if the tumor is in the right or on the left side of our colon, which is something that is still complicated. And plus, there are a number of events that are going to happen that can be providing further target for the treatment. Intratumoral heterogeneity is present in many kind of tumors, so is something that we have to deal any time, at least in our job. And there is not only genetic about, but is also something that we can see with immunotherapy, because if we analyze different spots of the same biopsy on a lung cancer, we have an expression of PD-L1 which is completely jeopardized. Same thing can happen if we compare brain metastasis to the primary tumor. Same thing about the total inflammatory infiltrate. We were listening yesterday about the hot and the cold tumor. The infiltrate can be completely different in different biopsies of the same prostate. The heterogeneity of expression of a target like NY-ESO is just in a part of an ovarian cancer. And we are going to talk about metabolism, which is something that we are focusing now. Or even metabolism can work in different way in different parts of the same biopsy, as you can see. So what we should do? And this is a question that I raise, because there is no answer from my point of view. We should implement our trial, asking to the company to provide us a better startup, not with one drug, but already with combo, using all the information we have from the analysis that we can do with genetic analysis that we can have at the beginning. But we should do this on the specimen of the patient that is going to be treated afterward, not on the specimen that we collected from the patient 2 years before the time of surgery, and use the same information to treat the patient 2 years after when he has a metastatic disease. This is a very important issue. And it is very complicated on the clinical point of view, because you can understand that if you're going to talk about a solid biopsy, not every organ is easily biopsiable, not any patient is available to receive a biopsy, and there is some risk of morbidity or complication of the biopsy that it should be taken in account. The second point is, do we have instruments, tools that can provide to us information about what is the dominant clone? Because in all the examples we have of a very prolonged remission, we have the evidence that there is a dominant clone, and we do not understand what is the percentage of expression of such target to be considered a dominant clone. Because we treat patients with a GFR mutation in 30% of the DNA. But 30% of the DNA, in my mind, means that there is a 70% of DNA that or is not available, or we do not know if it's the same kind of mutation. And probably this is the reason of progressive disease. But sometime, even if we start with this point, we have a complete control of the disease for years. And on the other side, we have a patient that are expressing a target in 90%, 95% of DNA, and we do not have the same result. So this is something that should be understood. Should we decide to use combination? Okay, we cannot defeat our tumor site with some kind of a drug. Okay, but every other part of the body is cured, at least apparently for the moment. Should we remove that part? Should we treat with radiation therapy? Yes. That, from my point of view, is going to implement, because where we cannot obtain a result with some kind of medical approach, probably we should integrate our approach. And those hypotheses should be provided also for trials. They should be considered as a possibility. Because how long to continue with the treatment is one of the major questions we have in clinic. And if we have a patient that has just single-site progressive disease, which is considered on progression, we should consider to go behind the progression with the drug, treating the lesion that is progressive. And this is not proven. There are not many trials that are designed in this such a way. So the future is going to be in treatment strategy and not single drug development. This is what we have to do, and we are in academy now. There is a merge of private, Foundation Medicine, company like that. But those companies, even if they have a private background, they for sure are interested in our academic research, because the strategy is going to improve the results, not developing a drug. And the second point that is very difficult to study with the actual study design is the sequencing of the treatment, how to sequence the treatment. Think a little bit about CDK4 and 6. We are talking about this because there is a drug coming on the market in these days. Well, we start with this treatment in patients with hormone-positive breast cancer, and apparently this is the best approach we can provide to this patient. What we are going to do afterward? Because the median progression-free survival is above 20 months, but is not forever. It is above 20 months. Sometimes those patients are going to progress. Should we consider a second kind of hormonal treatment? Can we provide something that is going to bypass resistance? Should we perform a second biopsy? And timing, which is, from my point of view, is one of the major issues I already told yesterday about immunotherapy. It's not, on my point of view, when we start the treatment is important. If the process is dynamic, we should consider to start the treatment in the proper moment. And for example, just an example, for all of you that are following a little bit the problem of microbiota and so on, one of the major issues about immunotherapy is of those patients that are receiving not steroids, but antibiotics. Apparently, they are conditioning the response to the immunotherapy much more than steroids, modulating our probiota that is modulating our immunity. Do we have system in the clinic to measure this and to provide an idea if we are doing the wrong thing because the patient had just a pneumonia before and we need to treat this and it's correct to start with the immunotreatment just afterward or not? Those are the questions we should provide and we should answer to our studies. The other way is to do what is going to present after my presentation, that there are many studies that are going to consider if we should study multiple targets at the same time in different tumors, multiple target at the same time in the same tumor, or set up, like we were discussing yesterday, platform, trying to assess where to put the patient, how to provide the patient. But all the studies have been done with platform, and you know we have the MD Anderson experience at the beginning, the IGR experience we're going to listen today, are going to treat with a lot of difficulties because of a regulatory reason, no more than 20% of the patients that are going to be screened, which is not much. And the second point is where we're not going to reach this dynamic evolution of the tumor with the biopsy, because, we perform biopsy, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 patients are available. But you know, biopsy is on one side. What about a patient that has a bone, lung, node, and liver mets? 4 different microenvironment, from different behavior, for different story on the clinical point of view, I must tell you. A bone disease is behaving completely different from a liver disease. Okay, what I have to biopsy? So liquid probably can provide more information and we trust a lot that in the future we will have more information about. Of course, with all the limitations that we have studying liquid. So not all the tests. I'm not sure that if methylation we can get from, you know, some gene and expression. Because sometimes we study methylation, they say MGMT, very interesting gene to study for methylation, but if methylation is present and the gene is still is expressing some kind of the protein, methylation is completely unuseful from our point of view, because the advantage that you take from this deficit of DNA repair is not any longer there, because there is still some kind of activity. So, I would say that we are not back in the future, like, because of the study design with the problem of if we have to make phase 2, phase 3, just phase 3, or whatever. But we have in a situation where we could implement our result if we can try to get more cooperative work between clinician and the endpoint in the clinic, that are to cure the patient, and the research. And many of the observations that are provided inside the information to promote the basic research, they come from the observational clinician nowadays. Thank you.